want to lift up Jesus for this wonderful resurrection Sunday. Amen. Now, I don't know about you, but resurrection calls for things to happen in my life.
All right.
Amen. It could not happen without your resurrection.
Yeah.
We prepare for the word. There's a song that I think everybody in here ought to be able to relate to. And I just want you to help me lift this up. Amen. And be prepared to hear the word of God.
All right.
Ah!
chapter, verses 12 through 16. Galatians 6 chapter, verses 12 through 16. Scripture says, those who are trying to force you to be circumcised are doing it for just one reason. They don't want to be persecuted for teaching that the cross of Christ alone can save you. And even those who advocate circumcision don't really keep the whole law. They only want you to be circumcised so they can brag about it and claim you as their disciples.
All right.
As for me, God forbid that I should boast about anything except the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Because of that cross, my interest in this world died long ago.
Well,
and the world's interest in me is also long dead. It doesn't make any difference now whether we have been circumcised or not. What counts is whether we really have been changed into new and different people. May God's mercy and peace be upon all of those who live by this principle. They are the new people of God.
Amen.
The title of today's word is, Don't Let My Looks Fool You. Don't let my looks fool you. Christians have to remind people that all the time. I've been changed.
All right.
Don't let my looks fool you. Anybody today,
Daddy,
when you look in the mirror, think about responses that you have, that you can truly say that you can change. Might not be all that you want to be.
Amen.
But you acknowledge that God has been working on your heart.
Amen.
Working on your tongue.
Amen.
Working on your attitude.
Amen.
That ought to be the testimony of all believers.
Amen.
That God is doing something new in my life. In verse 12, the scripture says, those who are trying to force you to be circumcised are doing it for just one reason. They don't want to be persecuted for teaching that the cross of Christ alone can save. A lot of folks don't. They want to feel that anything else can save you but the cross of Christ. Here, the church must serve the present age. And the 21st century world requires a 21st century church. A 21st century world that needs to be ministered to requires a 21st century church. Now, someone says, well, God does not change. You are correct. God does not change, but his methods do change. Things that he does to reach people at one time, he might not do to reach people at another time.
Well.
I've been further to do nothing about a computer or Facebook, YouTube. But God uses new methods of ministry. Circumcision here represents an old and possibly outdated way of doing ministry. Some people are so stuck to the way that they used to do it that they will literally allow their church to die before it changes.
Amen.
they will literally allow their ministry to die, become ineffective before they change.
Lord have mercy.
Circumcision represents an old and possibly outdated way of doing ministry. In the book of Genesis, God instructed Abraham. He told Abraham, said, Abraham, I want you to circumcise yourself. Those who will be said in chapter 6, verse 12 through 16, said those who are trying to force you to be circumcised, take it to Genesis chapter 17, verses 10 through 14, says this is the covenant that you and your descendants must keep.
Well,
each male among you must be circumcised. The flesh of his foreskin must be cut off. This will be a sign that you and they have accepted this covenant. Every male child, he's talking to Abraham. Every male child must be circumcised on the eighth day after his birth. This applies not only to members of your family, but it also applies to your servants, born in your household, and your foreign-born servants, whom you have purchased. Say this even applies to your slaves. All must be circumcised. Your bodies must bear the mark of my everlasting covenant. Said anyone who refuses to be circumcised will be cut off from the covenant family for violating the covenant. God tells Abraham to circumcise himself, his household, and his slaves as an everlasting covenant or agreement. But this agreement was done in the flesh. And he said that any male child who was not circumcised, they would be cut off from the family. And that was a covenant that God established with Abraham, but it was a covenant that was done by us in the flesh. But you know, times change. Things change. Sometimes God doesn't require some things that we felt that he required at other times. God moves into a more fulfilled state. Paul now, he teaches in Galatians chapter 6, verse 12, he teaches that the circumcision is no longer necessary. It was necessary for Abraham. But now, since Jesus, circumcision is no longer necessary to still be in the family. That God has moved to a new covenant with his people. But maybe, he said, you can, he's not saying that you can't do it any longer, because some people, tradition is, there's value in tradition, and there's value in culture, but we must not allow culture and tradition to stop the move of God. I'll give you an example. On first Sundays in our worship service, when we take communion, that it's been our culture and tradition that the women cover their heads. But that's just culture and tradition. That's just something done in human form by an act or a deed.
Well.
But what God really wants us to understand is his order. And so it does not matter if a woman comes and takes communion with her head uncovered. But if a church is stuck in tradition, they would literally offend someone over something that don't even matter. Do you think when God calls folk to heaven that he's looking for folk that took communion with their heads covered? That's just a physical deed. That was something that we do out of culture and tradition as we understood scriptures. But it's not a requirement for salvation. But where the church, where we fall short, sometimes we confuse our culture and tradition with the word of God. There's some things that we do out of culture. In our church service, in the AME church, there's certain times that you walk. There's certain times that you may remain still in respect to whether it's the word going for or a prayer going for, some scriptures going for. There's a time that you, but guess what? If somebody that don't know our cultures and our traditions, if they get up and start walking while someone's reading the scripture, they ain't going to hell. They can still see Jesus. That's not going to mess up their relationship with Christ. That's just how we do it in this church, but it don't make somebody wrong. But in ministry, we respect tradition and we respect culture, but we don't put too much weight or more weight on the culture or the tradition than should be placed on the act.
Amen.
And so, in ministry, we see where Paul is now teaching. He said, those of you and some of you all that are trying to force these cultures and these traditions on new folk that's coming to the Lord. And he said, folk are wanting to come, but as soon as they accept Christ, you are placing all of these rules that don't make a don't mount to a hill of beans as it relates to salvation on these people. And there are people out there that want to be a part of the church.
Yeah.
There are people out there that want to be. There are people out there that are trying to live saved in a very unhealthy way. Because God called for us as believers to work as a community. There are folk that want Christ, but they don't want church.
Come on.
And they need the church. They need the community. They need the support that comes from the church. But because so many times in the church, we confuse scripture with culture and tradition, we offend.
Amen.
And so even in a traditional church, which we are, we still have to make sure that we understand what's the word and what's our tradition.
Uh-huh.
And tradition can't be broken. It's the word of God that will always stand.
Yeah.
The word of God is what we don't change. So Paul teaches in Galatians, he says that circumcision is no longer necessary, but you may perform it for cultural purposes.
Uh-huh.
Paul clearly understands that the nature of our new covenant with God is no longer something done in the flesh.
Uh-huh.
He's going to a new height, a new place of revelation.
Uh-huh.
God is taking him to new heights and understanding what he really requires. But now of a spiritual nature is what God wants now.
Uh-huh.
And so this new covenant that God has agreed upon with us, it's not something that we get by doing something in the flesh.
Uh-huh.
But now it's a spiritual connection.
Yeah.
It's a bond that can't be broken. It's a bond that connects us to God and all of his promises. It's a bond that keeps us in the family. And so now we have this spiritual connection that God has covenanted with us. There are some things that we need to reconsider in the church.
Uh-huh. Well.
We must be careful not to impose non-spiritual practices on new converts.
Amen.
That's good that you and your mama and your grandmama and her grandmama, that's good that y'all did that.
Uh-huh.
But it's not necessarily necessary for salvation.
Amen.
And so I can share with you, this is some things that we did.
Uh-huh.
But I can't impose that you got to do it that way. Y'all look real pretty in your suits and your hats and your all your just nice little clothes. But somebody can come to church, guess what, on a communion Sunday in shorts and still be able to go.
Amen.
So we must understand that although this is something that we picked up and there's nothing wrong with it, there are going to be some that come that won't know that story. Some that won't relate. We're dealing in a different time now.
Amen.
All right. I look at some stuff that's cool now, and I can't even understand why it's cool. That there's some stuff that I just don't understand.
All right.
I don't understand why the brother got his pants way down there. It don't matter. It don't make sense to me. But for some reason, they think it's cool. I don't understand why the sister do what she do, but for some reason she's attracted to what she does. And so I can't judge her. I can't judge him. I have to accept that they live in a different world. And that there's one thing that if I can introduce them to Jesus, if there is something, there might not be anything they need to change. But if there is something that needs to be changed, he'll do it. He'll take care of it. I can't judge the brother based on his hair. I can't judge the brother based on his teeth. I can't judge the sister based on how short her skirt. I can't judge anybody. Introduce them to Jesus.
Amen.
Because guess what? Even some things that we're doing now, those of us who think we got it all together, some of our grandparents will look at us and think that we crazy. Things change. God shifts. God moves in different directions. And those who refuse to move will die in the wilderness. And so the church has to understand that there are some things that they can't, some weights that they can't put upon or impose upon new believers. Traditions serve good purposes. But traditions can't save you.
Amen.
Serve a good purpose. I love him. And I really do. I love him. Love the Holy Spirit. I love contemporary church.
Amen.
I love a little crazy, and I love him. I love some contemporary stuff too. I like rap. I like rap now in the world. Not just the lyrics a little different now. But ministry changes, and God can minister in ways that will blow your mind. Verses 13 through 14, he says, and even those who advocate circumcision. Those that are trying to push you back and force this stuff on you gotta look this way, you gotta walk this way, you gotta dress this way when you come to church. Those who are trying to advocate circumcision, they don't really keep the whole law themselves.
Amen.
Folks is trying to put all this stuff on you. They don't even get it all. He said they only want you to be circumcised so they can brag about it and claim you as their disciple. And so now when they see you show up. 23-year-old young lady come to church looking like you out the 40s. Now they think that this is one of my disciples. I showed this young girl how to do it. He says in the scripture, he says they don't even get it all right themselves. But they're trying to claim you as one of their disciples. 14 goes on and says, as for me, God forbid that I should boast about anything except the Christ of our Lord Jesus Christ. That any good Christian, any Christian with some good sense, realize it's all about the cross. I like all the service, but it's all about the cross. I have a plan when I start service, and the members know that there's something that we got to keep moving. But when the Holy Ghost says it's time to stop and spend a little time here, it's time to stop and spend a little time here. I like the things that are going on. I like the things that are being played. But in the end, it's all about the cross. Any good believer, any real believer will direct you to the cross. It's not about anything that I say. It's not about it. It's about the cross. And he says here in the scripture, he says that, as for me, God forbid that I should boast about anything. I'm nothing in myself, Paul said. He said, but it's the cross of Jesus Christ. Because of that cross, my interest in this world has died. He says, because of that cross, the world doesn't really even have interest in me anymore. Man. See, those are some things that we're going to understand. Some people will use outdated traditions for personal agendas at times to bring glory upon themselves and their deeds. But Paul declares that the only thing he will boast in is the cross of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The word circumcised means to cut around or to cut off. And Paul has experienced a sort of circumcision of the heart. See, Paul understands, and Paul understands circumcision and the process of circumcision. But he's experienced something a whole lot deeper. And he said, and he's experienced the circumcision of the heart. There's some things that he used to do. Paul used to torture Christians. Paul had Christians on his radar to destroy him. But he met a man on the road to Damascus. And when he met that man, it changed his whole life. And so Paul has experienced a sort of spiritual circumcision. And Paul here teaches in the Word, he teaches that because of that cross, his interest in the world is undergoing a cutting around and out of the world. He said it's because of what God has done to me. I don't have the same taste that I used to have. I heard Brother James Allen Sr. in the Sons of Valley breakfast yesterday. He mentioned, he said, there's some things that I used to struggle with. But he said that it was because of Jesus Christ. I don't even have the taste in my mouth anymore. He literally said, God took the taste out of his mouth as far as the east is from the west. And that's what the cross does for us. So when we look to the cross will begin to cut some things out of our lives. But not only will it cut some things out of our lives, but it'll cause other folk not to want to be around us anymore. Sometimes as Christians, we get bothered when folk don't, when we accept Christ and come to the church, and it seems like our friends don't want to deal with us anymore. Our friends don't want to have anything to do with us anymore. But what I'm telling you is because God has done something on the cross. And when folk are not right and you are right, there's something on the inside of you that just don't make them feel comfortable. And they're willing to cut you out of their lives. And so when you come to Christ and folk don't call you anymore, you ought to be excited that the cross is working in your life. Somebody say yeah. Somebody say yeah. Well, here in the scripture, Paul explains, he explained that I have to cut some things out of my life, and some folk in the world have cut me out of their life. And I, like Paul, I understand that tradition can help me maintain. Tradition is a good thing if I use it in the right way and its proper context and understand priority. And for this tradition, it helps me maintain. But the cross of Jesus Christ can make me better. See, what you don't understand, it was not the doxology that stopped me from being a womanizer. It was not the death blow that stopped me from cussing. It was not the order of service or how we do things in the AME church that stopped me from drinking and smoking. But what changed me was what he did on the cross. It changed folks. Today, that the cross made a world of difference in your life. See, the cross can make us better. We find ourselves not doing what we used to do, not saying what we used to say, and not going to places we used to go. And that's because of the cross that's made a wonderful change in our life. The cross of Christ has made us better. In verses 15 and 16, he goes on and says, take it back to 15, it doesn't make any difference now whether we have been circumcised or not. Did you hear that? I'm talking about believers, but it does not make a difference whether you've been circumcised or not, whether you know all the traditions or not, whether you know all the rules or not. But he says what really counts is whether we really have been changed. See, that's what you want to look at, not at my clothes and how holy I look on the outside, but listen to my mouth. Do you see holiness coming out my mouth? Look at my life. Do you see holiness coming out my life? And so when I sing the song, I know I've been changed. That's because the cross made a difference in my life. He said that we have been changed into new people. Got the same name, but I'm a new person now. Got the same title. I used to, you knew me as Mr. Rawls. I'm still Mr. Rawls, but I'm changed now. You knew me as Sister Brown. I'm still Sister Brown, but I'm changed now. He said we're different people. In verse 16, he closes out, and he says, may God have mercy and peace be upon you. And he says, those who live according to this principle. What am I saying to the believers? What am I saying? I'm saying that tradition is good. Knowing when to stand and when to sit is good. Wearing your hats, wearing your suits, wearing your ties, that's a good thing. But it can't save you. people expecting you to act like a clown. Because you still look the same. You look the same on the outside. But a wonderful change has happened on the inside. Don't let the looks fool you. Yeah, when you used to lie on me, I used to act a certain way, but I've been changed. Don't let the looks fool you. Yeah, I used to cut up. But I've been changed. I might look the same, but I'm new on the inside. I'm blessed on the inside. I don't think like I used to think. Don't let it look stupid. Stand to your feet. You know, today, God is just wanting some folk that want to be different. Folk that want to be able to sing the hook in 2 Chainz song. Don't sing the rest of it now. That's in the hell. But sing the hook, I'm different. Yeah, I'm different. God wants to change somebody in here today.
Yes.
And he don't care about all the other stuff. Doesn't care if you got all the traditional stuff down. Doesn't care if you have all the worship etiquette down. He doesn't care about all that. He just wants to get you in the family, in a covenant relationship. He wants to cause a spiritual circumcision. See, folks focusing on the flesh, the natural. God says, I want to cut some stuff out your heart. He said, the stuff you used to do, the stuff that used to get you excited, he said, that's the kind of stuff I want to cut away. He said, I want you to have some new desires. I want you to have a new love. But you know, when you do it now, folk gonna look at you and say, ain't nothing changed. Went down to that altar, knelt down, ain't nothing changed. He's still the same lie. She's still the same thief. Don't let the looks fool you. I might look the same, but I love deeper than I ever loved. I'm more committed to God than I've ever been. I'm more forgiving than I've ever been. I give out so much grace and so much mercy that I don't even understand why I'm forgiving for. Don't let the looks fool you. Today, I want to offer the opportunity for someone to come in this covenant with Christ. Come on, a spiritual covenant. Nothing about the flesh. We pick up tradition and culture along the way, and that's good. Doctrine is good. But no, somebody that wants to cut away all that old stuff and come to Jesus. I want you to come to the altar and kneel down. If you'd like to come and give your life to Christ, I want you to kneel down. If you'd like to come and rededicate, I want you to come and kneel down. If you need a church home, you were convinced that you thought you could do it by yourself, but you realize, hey man, I need a church home. I need somebody to feed me some good feed. I need a church home. If you need a church home, I want you to come, whatever your reasons are. If you need to be to this altar, I want you to come now.